Boston-based work. It was because I was working on writing fiction. I'm a fiction writer. I'm also a community organizer, which means I work for social change, specifically for equity, gender, and caste, and class. So what I'm doing as a community organizer is trying to move for more community libraries in Delhi. We run one branch of our library as our flagship. It's a learning lab, which means as we run the library, we're trying to learn how to run the library. And you might think that it's a really obvious thing because you have a library here and it's set up for you. You might think it's an obvious thing that a library is just a place that has books and then you go and you get them. But different populations need different kinds of libraries. Everybody needs their library to be free. Yours is not free, your parents pay for it. If it was free, other people could come in and use it, but they cannot. Delhi needs lots and lots of free libraries. Everybody needs free libraries. There's just a small handful of free libraries in Delhi. So for example, if you wanted to go to a free library in Delhi, you could. It's run by the government of Delhi, and most places in the world would do better than Delhi does in terms of how many libraries are available per person. You know, so what we are doing in the community library that I run is we're trying to figure out how to run a community library, A, in a society where there aren't enough community libraries, and what that means for trying to get access. So if there's only a small number of good things and a lot of people who need those good things, those essential good things like food and shelter and books and learning and thinking, because books, learning and thinking is how you access your citizenship and your rights and your ability to act in the world and to tell your story and to be heard. So if there's only a small number of those things, then accessing them becomes this issue that's complicated by scarcity. And so we have to figure out how to run our library in a community where the walking distance diameter from our library, maybe a kilometer out in all directions, could easily cover about 20,000 people. And our entire library would possibly fit inside this room. So obviously 20,000 people cannot come into this room and borrow books. So we're looking at that, at scarcity and making available a good and essential thing and making it available to as many people as possible. Do you put shelves from the ceiling to the floor? Do you have rotating shifts? Do you ration? Do you say, like, some people can use it in the AM and some people in the PM and so on? The other issue is, I don't know if this would be true for anybody in this room, but for most of our library members, they are first-generation readers. That means their parents may have at most like a kind of minimal level of literacy, something that allows them to use reading in a very utilitarian way, say to read a street sign or to make a to-do list of three items, each one word long. But actually, for the most part, they cannot even do that. They may have gone to school up to class two. So what happens with literacy is if you don't use it, it actually goes away. Say you learn your ABCs and then you go on and you learn how to put them together in three-letter words and five-letter words and three-word sentences, and then you sort of haltingly beginning to read in class two. And then you don't do it for the next 20 or 30 years, and now you are a parent and you have children. You cannot, for example, read to your child or know what they are reading when they read, or help them with their homework, or understand what reading means to them or what it could mean to them, because it means so little to you. Mostly, I mean, it means this big thing that you can't access the world, so you know that's important for your child, but to bridge the difference between knowing what reading is not doing for you and what it would like to do to your child, do for your child, and to bridge between that and knowing what it could actually do for your child, and then, you know, understanding that, that's a huge gap. So our library serves first generation learners, and that means somebody walking in the room. If you were to walk into your library and find that it was meant for mostly, you know, sort of college level chemistry students, you would have a really hard time figuring out how to use that library, because it wouldn't be exactly meant for you. our library is working very hard to figure out how it can be exactly meant for first-generation learners. And there are specific things like we have to make that bridge between the parent and the child, between the school and the child. We have to make the bridge between not knowing what reading can do for you beyond allowing you to read a street sign or make a to-do list, and what it could do for you in as much as it could allow you to express yourself. So how we do that is something that I could talk about more later. I want to ask for your help just running this little video that shows you what our library looks like. It doesn't look like this. This is some sort of, it's like a free image from the internet. I'm not sure why it's the first thing you see. But it's a lot of the video is in Hindi, but there are subtitles. So you can look up and try to pay attention.
Hello, my name is Shubha. मैं दीपाली कम्युनिटी लाइब्रेरी में वॉलंटियर की तरह आ रही हूँ और मुझे आते हुए 1.5 साल से ऊपर हो गया है और 3 बजे जब ये लाइब्रेरी खुलती है तो दरवाजे के बाहर लाइन देखने वाली होती है, पूरी सड़क के पीछे तक लाइन दौड़ रही होती है, बच्चे उमड़ उमड़ के आते हैं।
You can have as many as 50 children waiting in line to use the library. When you go into the door of the library, your turn may take half an hour to 40 minutes to come. Your turn for going in.
Sultana's dream, Ribbonary Nakimayan's Madhuri Day. So there have been some amazing books we've been able to share with children and adults.
I think we have to making the stories interesting, because only then you want to open a new book and see and go on a journey of discovery for themselves.
So Mr. Clayton comes once a week to the
children. Take us back!
You can see a lot of the children are your age, but they're still getting read alouds because they didn't get them when they were
activities yahan hoti hai, art and craft kiya jata hai, workshops hoti hai, science ke bare mein bataya jata hai, different workshops ke zariye, which makes it very interesting for the children.
Ye library
Sultana
Madhuri Day ke upar ये लाइब्रेरी खुद से अगर चलाने के लिए स्टूडेंट काउंसिल मेंबर को ले कर रहा है।
So the library is also run by a student council, mostly 13 to 19 year olds.
तो इसके लिए आप अपनी लाइब्रेरी की टाइमिंग्स को एक्सपेंड करने वाले हैं ताकि सबको टाइम मिले।
वर्कशॉप भी ज़्यादा करनी होगी, फिर जो वर्कशॉप में बच्चे आएंगे वो दूसरे बच्चों को बताएंगे, इसी से फिर और बच्चे आएंगे।
जैसे कि हमें मैम भी बताती है कि रीडिंग एक्सपैंड थिंकिंग, अगर कुछ पढ़ रहे हो तो मतलब सोच रहे हो, सोचना रीडिंग से ही बढ़ता है और एग्जाम्स पर कम्युनिटी वर्क में भी जानते हैं।
Because Dipali opened its doors and said they were houses, because the Lion Trust said they were fond of creating a library here with their funding, we were able to say to the community at large who wants to come volunteer.
This initiative, we noted that Dipali should coordinate with us and do it. A lot of children are taking benefit of that library and coming with a lot of happiness, which I could see in their eyes.
As a result of its successful work, Dipali began its second library and the Sanjay Colony Learning Center with the aim of reaching to more people in the communities.
So we want that parents also come and see that school se badhkar bhi bahut kitabe hain jo unko future ko aage badhane mein matlab bahut helpful hai.
Hum chahte hain ye movement jaise shuru ho jaye, so movement matlab bachcho dwara, parents dwara, community dwara ye kitab logo ke ghar mein jaye.
Maine Manuel ma'am ke mom ko sikha, jaise ki main yahan par na story books zyada padhti hu aur kya kehte hain matlab khane ki dishes hoti hai wo bhi dekhti hu.
Mujhe library mein drawing karna acha lagta hai.
This is a world of books.
मुझे लाइब्रेरी में हर हफ्ते नए किताबें मिलते हैं.
मुझे लाइब्रेरी में कहानी सुनना अच्छा लगता है.
This place is very innovative.
In the coming years, Dipali expects to build community libraries in all of its learning centers and elsewhere, so that we can bring a great change in our communities with with a brighter future for a better tomorrow. To know more and to support the work of Dipalya's community-based library, contact us immediately. We wait to hear from you.
So a lot of what's happening in India and in specifically in Delhi is there is a national curriculum in India. Most nations, most countries have that. Somewhere there will be an office where people decide what the children of that country need to learn. There could be extra things you learn based on the kinds of schools you go to. Maybe a country might decide, as India did, that everybody needs to learn Hindi, that there should be this national language that unites people, and that people should have access to English. If not immediately, if you go to a free government-run school in India, you probably don't get English classes till a few years into your education, but that at some point English would be introduced to you. But most of the private schools, most of the private schools provide English right from the start, so you would be learning English and Hindi, and that would be part of the nationally understood curriculum that is necessary for the child to, you know, to develop. And it would be required by the government that this curriculum be made available to children. You couldn't call yourself a school if you didn't provide those basic things. Additionally, in India, kids are given a third language. So in that nationally devised curriculum, there is very little about library. So one place in many countries where children access books and learning and reading is through the curriculum saying that the schools should provide libraries. The other place that people access libraries at all ages is in the country's recognition that there should be free libraries that are open to everyone, that anyone off of the street could walk in. For example, in most countries, you don't even need a membership card to just go in and sit down. And then if you want to, you could get a membership and it would be free. You might have to show an ID or something, but then you would get membership and then you'd be able to not only sit down, but take a book and leave, and then return the book and take another one, and so on. So there's very little of that happening in India right now. It's happening, but almost like a token gesture. So in Delhi, a city of about 20 million, we have about 36 libraries. So, you know, we're asking for something like 400,000 people to enter one of these libraries at a time, if everybody's going to have access to libraries, those kinds of numbers. So what happens in our curriculum right now is that reading is looked at as something that you need to learn so that you can get equipped to do a job in life. So if you go to a school that is run by the government, probably your parents are working class people and you're in that school and you're preparing to be a member of the working class. The education you're given is education that's designed for you to be able to maybe turn on a machine or work through a script and make a phone call, to be able to, at most, maybe, you know, write a letter, for example, a letter asking for a leave of absence because someone in your family is sick. These are things that are essential to being able to hold a job. When you are at work and you need a day off because someone in the family is sick, you probably don't just say that. You have to give it in writing so that your employer, maybe you work for Verizon, that the phone company, or a cable TV company, or in a bank. Even if you are doing a very, very simple job in that bank, you need a level of literacy that allows you to put in that letter of application. So in the national curriculum, for example, by 10th grade, you have to be able to write that letter, and you're tested on that. So you guys are being given an education that's supposed to prepare you for whatever resembles what your parents do. Does that make sense? You get to go to this school because your parents come from a particular class and you get a kind of education that prepares you to enter that place in society. Most of the people in the world don't get to do that, right? You know that. Most of the people in the world end up doing whatever their parents are doing and they get the education that's designed to prepare them for that. The vast majority of India is going to go work in factories, it's going to go work in call centers. One of our library members in that circle, sitting in the student council circle, his name is Sumit, he's 19 years old. He has a job connecting the phone call, so he doesn't even do the script part of the call, and it's to calls abroad. So if somebody abroad has defaulted on their loan payment, say Bank of America lent out some money to somebody to buy a house and then they stop paying for that, somebody in India has to call that person and say, you've defaulted on your loan and we are now transferring your loan to a collection agency. Sumit's job is to call the person based off of a list he's given, and he spends all night doing this. And when he calls the person, so he has to be able to read a list, he has to be able to pick up the phone and dial correctly, he has to be able to call and say, hello, is this Mr. whoever the person is. And the minute that person says, yes, it is, Sumit makes the patch that allows the next person to continue with the script. So these sorts of jobs exist in the millions all over the world. And in India, we're specializing in doing these kinds of works that require a certain kind of literacy. So the Indian education system is driven to providing an education that equips people with the skills possible, necessary to do this kind of job. What we're missing is opening books and reading them to figure out who we are and what do we think about all this. The stuff that's happening to us, this life we inhabit, this society that we're a part of, what our neighbors think life should look like, do we agree with that, do we disagree with that? See, we're all thinkers, regardless of our education or our access to books, and we're all thinking. We're thinking while we're waiting for a bus on the streets of Delhi. We're thinking while we're patching a call together that someone who's defaulted on a loan is going to end up in a conversation with. When we think, if we don't have access to books, we missed out on a very powerful tool for thinking. Literature, particularly fiction, made up stories about how societies work, about what falling in love looks like, what boys think about girls and what girls think about boys and who we want to be when we grow up and what the future is about and how future relates to past. These are big, big questions in literature that thousands of years worth of people have thought hard about. So if you don't know how to pick up that book and really read it, and if we don't know that when we read, we're not just learning, we're actually thinking. If we don't know that, then we're not thinking. And if we're not thinking, then we've just missed out on a powerful tool for thinking, so that we as thinkers are weakened by our lack of access to literature. So while the school does a great job of preparing people to work and to be workers in this global economy of which we are a part, not giving kids access to reading and books for thinking, and that can, it means that you missed out on that tool for thinking. What that actually looks like is you get up in the morning and you get ready and you go to school and you have a bag of books, and the bag of books is textbooks. And you carry all your textbooks to school with you, and you go through the day, period by period. You have social studies and it's got a social studies textbook. It's one book that lasts your whole year. It may have a workbook with it, and it may ask you questions like, who was the first president of the United States? And what year did India get its independence? It depends on what year you are in school and so on. And then you have your English period, and you have your Hindi period, and you have your maths period. You might have a science period. And then the day is done. And you may have read 2 pages in your social studies book and 1 page in your English book, or you may not have read at all. At the end of the day, you may have spent maximum 10 or 12 minutes or 15 minutes reading. And then you go home and you obviously, unless you have homework that requires you to answer in your worksheet who the first president of the United States was, you're not going to want to open that really boring book, which is all about just giving you a finite set of facts and absolutely no thinking about those facts. So you don't open the book, and there is no community library, and there's no library in your school. Or there might be a library in your school, but the librarian keeps it closed and you don't get to come in and take the books. Or she might be a really nice librarian and there's no money in the library to replace books that are lost. But nevertheless, somehow, because maybe she reads and she knows how good it feels to read, she might put out 2 dozen books, and once a week you're allowed to come in and choose among the 2 dozen books and take it home. So that's what life might look like if you're in 8th grade in a government school in India. It could be a little different and a little better in terms of access to reading if you're a middle class kid going to a nicer school, which has more resources and more access built into it. If your parents were readers themselves, they might put you in line at the cash register at the bookstore to buy a book, and that's not the same thing as a library at all. So that's kind of the state of reading in India today. And it has huge impact on questions like domestic violence. It has huge impact on questions like caste, because if you are a thinker and you are wondering why this caste system exists, and you read in your social studies book that for thousands of years in India we've had a caste system, and at the top there is this, and then there is this, and then there is this, but in the Constitution of India it is outlawed. And if that's all you ever know from your reading, but your mind is telling you something else is going on, but there's no library where you can go and take down a book and see who else thinks about this and what have they thought. And in a storybook where there's someone from an upper caste and someone from a lower caste and they have a relationship with each other, and what does that look like? And you don't have access to that storybook, then you just lost out on a powerful opportunity to think powerfully about caste. Your mind is questioning, but your questions don't have nearly the shape they could have had. So this is the relationship between libraries, literature, reading, books, and all the big questions we have about how our society holds together. Whether it's a question of why do we have the caste system, how do we demolish it, is it really demolished, is it enough that the Constitution says it's outlawed? I've heard it, you know, that there is no such thing as caste anymore, but then I know that my mother works cleaning and sweeping in people's houses, and they keep a separate glass for her when she needs to drink, and she can never ask, can I use the bathroom in this house? Because it's just known that she can't. And I went with her once to hang out while she was finishing work, and I needed to use the bathroom, but she said, shh. And so I knew I should just hold and not go, even though there were four bathrooms in that house. So if you have certain lived experiences, but you don't have access to a powerful way to think about it, your thinking might not be able to go where it would, no matter how intelligent you are. Okay, so that's the library talk. And how much time do I have?
So this is 5.
Okay, and it's 44 now. So I should take questions?
I have one.
Because we have about 10 minutes now, so I'll do...
We have about 20 minutes, because it's EE, so we'll finish by 12...
12, 15.
15.
Yeah.
12, 15. So we have 20 minutes, so...
We have a lot of time.
Okay. Okay.
Let's do this.
We'll do a few questions, and then
yeah,
I can...
Yeah, a couple minutes. Everybody kind of think about what question you're going to ask now. You can talk, but about 2-3 minutes, can you just generate what question you're going to ask? Ms. Goshi.
Okay.
Because
Lydia
see
your topic as
right.
well.
Right. Lydia
so
is related to everything, right?
So what I didn't cover in the talk about the library is that I have ended up having to research caste. I've ended up having to think about gender and research that. Because the books I've written, fictional books, have covered characters in situations that have to do with questions like gender, violence, caste. The big questions that I said books address. I've always wanted as a writer to tackle those questions, and as a reader I've been reading about those questions. So please take your time and think of some questions.
Yeah, like a few minutes. Steve, okay.
Just so that there's tables of
I think she would
drag.
But what we should do is just like when you're talking, we should like either, yeah, I mean, go to the kids, but
please raise your hand and then make sure you are ready to take notes too, right? So
is it going to take a video? My question is, how do you think child labor has prevented kids from getting an education? And
okay, how about I take two or three questions and then see if I can wrap it into one if possible or not?
Did your library inform children about child labor and human trafficking? Did you tell the children this is what happens in the world and we should stay away from this or try to avoid these things?
And so for me, it said waste is a topic, and so I wanted to know what knowledge you have on rag figures.
So how can child labor be prevented in India and things that I think, so many different things have to probably come together, because child labor has many dimensions to it. For example, we know in the United States, where child labor was tackled a few decades ago, that once things like minimum wage law came into place, there was no longer an incentive to hire children because children were weaker and would work for less, politically weaker, not able to say no to the employer. Say you were hired to do burgers, you know, in a burger joint for like, you know, so many dollars an hour, $8 an hour, and then the next day the employer came to you and said, you were hired for $8, but I'm only going to pay you $4 starting tomorrow. A grown-up might have a way of fighting back that a child wouldn't, and so child labor would often be perpetuated because there wouldn't be a minimum. And once the minimum was put in place and an employer could no longer go down, so the child's weakness was bolstered by a strong law and a strong enforcement of the law. There were inspectors coming to see that everybody got the right wages and so on, and there were unions. The law didn't just happen because the government put it in on its own, you know, they woke up one morning. There was a long fight, decades long in the United States, where organized groups of workers in the form of trade unions fought for the minimum wage law. When that went into effect, child labor fell dramatically because an employer no longer had an incentive to have a child in the workforce. That in conjunction with things like free public education. So many, many children in the library, not the majority of them, not even a significant minority, but some minority of members in my library don't go to any school at all. And there are free schools in India, but they are limited in number. All the children almost in my library, some 900 people come in and out of this room every week to take books. That's the size of the library and that's how many books we're issuing each week. The vast majority of them go to school in shifts. The girls go to school in the morning from 8 o'clock to 1 o'clock, and the boys from 12:30 to 6:30, something like that. And that's because there's a limited number of school buildings that are free and open to children to come in. So when you have this kind of scarcity, even though we are a country that says guaranteed free education till age 14, and it's written in our constitution, the government has not put enough resources into making the school available. In the United States, the free public education means that many parents see that as a viable thing. Losing the child's earning power is offset by the fact that the child gets to go to a free school that doesn't cost the parent anything. And there are enough schools and kids don't have to go in shifts and they don't have to pay for school uniforms on the side, even though the school is free, the parents having to pay for the uniform. The school also will provide a free lunch if the child is too poor to be able to bring a lunch from home. All of these things act as an incentive to the parents so that the parent is no longer thinking, we have to make ends meet, I can't afford the school uniform. Plus she has to go to school in the morning, but her brother has to go in the afternoon, and who's going to take care of her brother who's really little when I go to work in the morning and she's at school in the morning? These kinds of thinking, which goes on in our library memberships, families, which results in some of them not going to school at all, can be tackled with like free schools that are open to everyone, and enough numbers of those free schools, and enough good quality education in those free schools, a minimum wage that's enforced. Enforcement mechanisms are important. You can't just have laws. Laws are meaningless if there isn't a way to make sure that they're being implemented on the ground. So these things have been found historically to work. What I see in the library is that there are children who don't get to go to school. Sometimes they don't get to go to school because of the gender question. They are girls, and in a family with maybe a number of girls and a number of boys and a lack of resources, a family might make a decision to allow the boy to go to school but to keep the girl at home. Also, because of the way work is gendered, caring and nurturing work is done in all societies, American, English, French, you know, Korean, Chinese, Indian. We all have have cultures in which nurturing work is done by women and girls more and less by men and boys. And it can even be threatening if a boy has to do it, threatening in the sense of, wait, you're not a boy if you're doing that, that kind of stuff. So given this thing, which isn't about governments and laws, the gender issues are our cultural issues, right? Given this, sometimes in families of our library members, a decision is made that there's a little boy, he's at home, he's a baby, mother works, father works, mother leaves the house at 5 a.m. to sweep and swab in other people's homes, father goes to work in a factory or to drive an auto rickshaw. Somebody has to take care of the baby. Of the older siblings, let's let the boys go to school. And let's keep one of the girls home to take care of the baby in the house. Or it may even be that school has a policy that says 8 a.m. the door opens. If you're not in within the first 10 minutes after it opens, then we're not letting you in. And maybe in that house, everybody's making every effort to make sure everybody gets to go to school. But after mom goes to work at 5 a.m., sister has to get everybody dressed and everybody, their school lunches packed and then set them out. And she's always lost. And so she never makes it in that 10 minutes. So maybe the school needs a more flexible policy. But why does the school have such an inflexible policy? Are they so lacking in compassion, or are they so clueless about the needs of their students? It could be the school actually very thoughtfully has a very hardcore policy about excluding people, because the school knows that if it tries to be inclusive, there are actually more people outside than there is room inside. So they kind of arbitrarily have to get rid of some people. Why not say 8:10, if you're not in the door, you don't get to come in at all today? So again, it goes back to how many resources are being brought into the education field. So that affects child labor, that affects access to schooling, and access to schooling then goes on to affect child labor in turn. We have a small program in the building in which I run the library. It's a bridge program for children who don't go to school right now. All of them are girls, almost all of them are not in school because they're taking care of siblings. So this is not a government-run program. Some NGO is funding it. I'm not involved with it, but I watched it operate. So this group of girls who are ages maybe 4 or 5 up to 14 or 15 come to the building in which our library is. They come to a different part of the building where there's a classroom in which they are trying to keep up with their studies. And they have very flexible rules in that classroom about the time you come in. They even have so much flexibility that if you have your baby with you, your baby brother or sister, a 2-year-old or a 1-year-old, and even if she's crying or carrying on and disrupting the class, you can bring the baby with you to class. So it's a bridge program to try to get you through this difficult spot in your family's life so that you can, at some point, still be caught up enough in your education to go back into school. Maybe the baby grows up 2 years from now. You can leave the baby alone at home, and it's time for you to go back to school and you haven't fallen so far behind. So programs like that can be very helpful. Some of our library members attend this bridge program and then they come to the library also. Waste and rag pickers, very quickly. So this book I wrote, Bicycle Dreaming, is the story of a girl whose father works as a kabadiwala. So India is one of the major recycling countries in this world. A giant percentage, it depends on who and what paper you read, maybe as much as like 70% of like the plastic that is used in this country gets recycled. Really, really, really good countries out there, like Scandinavian countries or a part of the United States I've lived in Portland, Oregon is well known for its recycling program, might manage to recycle about 20%. But you can look up these numbers. I'm not really trusting my own numbers and don't want to be quoted on them. But the difference between how much India recycles and how much a good Western country recycles is dramatic. One of the reasons why India recycles as much as it does is because for thousands of years there's been a caste of people in India, a group of people who generationally are forced to do the work of cleaning. Whether they're manual scavenging, which still exists in India, for example, in the railway system, which is the biggest employer in India, one of the biggest employers in India, the army is another one, the railway system still has what's called a dry latrine, which means when you use the toilet in the train, when the train is in motion, the your waste matter lands on the tracks, right? There's a little flush, but it doesn't get stored in a tank, and then the tank doesn't get emptied later with suction pipes, and then the empty tank doesn't get loaded into another tank, and then the other tank doesn't get loaded to go to the sewage plant where there's waste treatment. That could happen in some other societies, but the Indian railway system and rural India in households and many, many other employers in India still use a dry toilet system, which means that somebody with a piece of board in their hand, often barefooted and barehanded, walks the tracks, thousands and thousands, tens, hundreds of thousands of kilometers worth of tracks in India to pick up the waste and dispose of it. Many miles of those tracks they don't have to pick up because the rain comes and cleans it, but closer to cities and so on, and if you're in the New Delhi railway station, you'll see the manual scavengers are doing this. We were talking a little earlier about enforcement of laws. In the books, in the law, it says manual scavenging is illegal. But we have a major governmental organization that hires and has on staff, somehow they've finagled it, manual scavengers who pick up. So yes, it's great that we do all this awesome plastic recycling. It's not so great that someone might be born, and from the day they're born, relegated to a caste that requires them to pick up and clean behind people. It's become lucrative, commercially viable, to go pick up plastic. It's a good thing about the Indian recycling system that people want to purchase plastic that has been reused. So there's virgin plastic, and plastic is a petroleum-generated product. So as petroleum prices all over the world go up and down, plastic can go up and down. As it goes up and down, and especially as it goes up rather, the not virgin plastic, plastic that was used once, say the top of your cup at Starbucks, you know, is plastic. And if you're getting a cold drink in Starbucks, it's also plastic. That's all recyclable. Once it gets recycled, it can be melted down because somebody actually finds it lying on the street and picks it up. For all of us who are offended to see how much garbage there is on the street, we also probably, hopefully, notice that it all goes away after a while. Otherwise, wouldn't we just all be living in a permanent landfill? In fact, there are landfills in Delhi, on the outskirts of Delhi, and there are people who pick up all of it. A day after you drop that thing on the ground, your Starbucks cup, or somebody else, if you don't do that kind of dropping, somebody else does it. Or say you drop it in your kitchen garbage can, somebody picks it up, right? And it goes down the street, usually it gets dumped in a corner. Throughout this neighborhood, for example, there are street corners where there's piles of garbage. It's all your own household garbage. Once it goes there, people go and they go through it and sort what's recyclable. If you haven't been sorting in your home, dry from wet, and sometimes even when you sort, it just gets mixed back up again, but then it gets resorted. So that cost of people are engaged in picking up that waste, sorting it, and then some of it's going to the landfill, some of it is going to incinerators, which has its problematic aspects when waste gets burned, and then some of it is going so that it can get recycled and then reused in a different kind of plastic product. Starbucks will not use a non-virgin plastic because when you pay for that cup of coffee, you want something shiny in your hand. But some other people will maybe buy a household bucket to take a bucket bath, and that will be not virgin plastic. We all know when you have those buckets to be careful to not overfill and pick it up by its handle because the handle will pop right off because it's quite weak, and if it's overly loaded, that bucket, and you pick it up, the bottom might crack also. So the plastic weakens as it's used. So there's many, many aspects to this waste thing. One quick thing about research is there's a waste pickers colony right next door to your school, and it burned a couple of years ago, but I think burnt down, but I think they've tried to rebuild it. And Mr. Creighton and I, because I was working on this book, once went with a waste picker for a whole day in this neighborhood. That's why I know that where your garbage goes for the most part is not into a truck that drives it out of the city to a landfill, which is a good thing that it goes to a street corner where people can pick through it because then it gets sorted. We know this because we accompanied a man who lives in that basti, in that waste workers colony, and we spent the day on bicycles riding around with him, and he did this work of going from pile to pile and looking for things that he could recycle.
So, I'm sorry.
Oh, we just have about 8 minutes left. Are there other questions before? I know that these two groups, I heard your questions. Do you guys want to ask those questions?
Do you think a better education for the whole society could stop discrimination on lower caste people because the society gets more open-minded with education?
Yeah, I think being open-minded is very important. And I said, like, reading for thinking instead of just reading to learn how to run a machine or to obey a command, reading to comply with human resource policy like submitting a letter of application for a leave of absence. Reading for thinking about questions like, who am I? What kind of society do I want to belong to? I think all of you have read fiction and had that experience of going, I understand better now. I understand better why the world looks the way it looks. Or, whether you had it consciously or unconsciously, if you stop and think about it, books have been doing something to you, right? And in many cases, making you want to read more. In many cases, a question you had in your mind got answered only to provoke more questions so that you kept thinking more and more and more. When people don't have access to that business of being closed-minded isn't just, just like prejudice as if, you're filled with hatred, but it could be prejudice that just never got challenged by reading. So, if you had a prejudice around who should do what kind of work, they're not much, they're not thinkers, or they're this color, or they're that class, so they should do what they do, I should do what I do. I'm smart, I should grow up and make policy. They're not, they should grow up and clean behind me. Those sorts of prejudices would be challenged in literature, and having access to literature would open everyone's mind, right? So more education means more access to literature, but also within more education, there has to be curriculum that says everyone should have access to the same kind of education. So whatever the national curriculum is, should not be so different from what some other people in a nation are getting, who are getting more than the national curriculum. I keep mentioning the United States because I lived there for 20 years. I've lived in this country for the majority of my life, but I lived a long time in the United States, and I know something about the US history. About the history of the United States, and the big fight in the United States in the 50s and 60s, I mean, it had its roots in earlier times also, but especially in the 50s and 60s, the civil rights fight came to a head, and a lot of that fight coalesced around equal education for all. So what we have in India is not equal education for all. We have segregated education. Some people go to one kind of school, some people go to another kind of school. If a government policy said everyone can go to whatever kind of school they want, but the baseline, the bottom, the minimum education that's offered will as closely as possible resemble the maximum education that's possible. So here we have a school that isn't for boys in the afternoon to evening and girls in the morning. It's for everyone. Well, then that means the baseline should also resemble that. That girls should have an opportunity to go to a school that boys are at, and that they should learn together, and that they shouldn't have to go by shift, which makes for a shorter school day, and it also makes for parents having to juggle how they can send siblings. I mean, if your parents had to worry about one set of school buses in the morning and another set in the afternoon, and different collection times for different children, it would make it possible maybe to decide, hey, maybe only some of the kids in the family should go to school, because I can't do all of it. So the minimum has to get closer to the maximum.
We have about 4 minutes left, and I just want to say, you guys are doing the Population Project. I feel like you are living the Population Project, about the research you're doing, and you are following around, looking at waste management, and you're constantly researching, and you're finding out that research, but then you take that research and you're going, what's next? What can I do to make an impact? And that's so powerful to see, and we're really happy to experience that today. I know I am.
there's a few other questions that I heard when I went around and asked some of the students what they were thinking. One was about adults and using your library, and one was about abuse at the home. Have you ever seen your library impact a situation where you were able to say, wow, my library was a positive effect on this person?
I wouldn't be able to do this work if I didn't see that almost on a daily basis, and there's just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of stories now in the library about how people have benefited from being able to read and think. When we celebrate reading milestones in the library, so if you read 10 books, you get a packet of biscuits and you get a book of your own to own. In many cases, it's the first time you've owned a book in your life other than a school book that was given to you as part of the school's textbook. So at 80 books, there's another milestone, and you have an opportunity to write little book reports. And if you write 20 of these book reports, you're in the running to become a member of the 100 book club. When you've read 100 books and 20 of those book reports have been turned in, you can get a school bag, and it's a nice school bag, and it's got 5 or 6 good books in it. Those are all your own books, and it's got a notebook, and it's got a pencil box with an eraser and a pencil, and it's got color pencils. And this is all very, very wonderful. And we run a thing called the book report clinic in the library, kind of like a doctor's clinic where you go to get help with your health. Kids come in, and they might be 6 years old, or they might be 14 years old, and they've never written a book report. They've never written read a book and then been asked, what do you think of the book? So one of these book report clinics, I had this youngster come in, and she said yesterday, it was a book called The Boy Who Asked Why. It was a picture book. Her name is Pinky Shankar Prasad, and this girl who read the book, and it's a picture book. The Boy Who Asked Why is a picture book that tells the story of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. He wrote the Constitution of India, and he was a member of the lowest caste of India. So back in the 1920s or 30s, he got himself a college education, went abroad, came back to India, found that with his doctorate degree, he still couldn't get housing because there was discrimination against his caste where people weren't willing to rent a home to him. He went on to become one of the freedom fighter struggle people of India, and to write the Constitution of India, and to be a very important intellectual and a thinker, and to shape how people in India, especially the lowest caste in India, who look to him for leadership, even today, long after he has passed away. He is like the Gandhi of some people in India. He is the father figure, the person who gives them direction in life. So this picture book is his story of his childhood. And Pinky Shankar Prasad read this book, and then she read it out loud to her parents at home, and then she came into the book report clinic, and she said, what do I think of this book? I think this book is telling the story of my caste. And I got the chills, because that's what I hope we're doing in the library, is giving people a chance to see themselves in literature, to see how important they are, and how important their thinking is, so that they can think more powerfully, and in time, become, you know, people who can act as agents for change in their own society. This boy Sumit and that circle of kids who sat in a circle making plans for the library, more workshops, community walks, expanded hours, that's our student council. There's about 15 of those kids. They're ranging in age from 13 to 19, and they run the library with me. So they own the library because their work gives them ownership of the library. They're already preparing to make change in society because they're learning organizing skills. If there's an issue, missing books, how do we tackle it? On a daily basis, how do we deal with the fact that this many square feet, this many thousand books, that many tens of thousands of people trying to get in? We don't like the way schools ration, we're not going to ration. How do we run a system without rationing? These kinds of questions, kids your age are thinking about, and they're getting ready, I think, to rule the world someday. Through their access to the library and through their access to thinking in the library.
How old is Pinky?
Pinky is, I think she's 13, 14, yeah.
Can we give a round of applause?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, so do you have the lunch in
the
back?
No, no,
no.
You can display.